Hello, welcome to a new lecture of Math S401, Dynamic Optimization. Today we're going to extend the theory that we have seen before, which is vector spaces, normed vector spaces, and then Banach spaces as being normed vector spaces on which every Cauchy sequence also converges. Okay, today we're going to extend or build upon this theory to define the notion of a contraction mapping, and we're going to see that contraction mappings give fixed point results on vector spaces. Okay, so to start, remember that we denoted by X and then the norm. This was a normed vector space. And we're going to look for functions that take elements in the vector space to other elements in the vector space. Okay, so T is a function from X to X. However, in some cases, we have seen that X, for example, was the phi norm, was a set of all functions from A to R. Okay, so this was a set of all functions from A to R that are continuous and bounded in this phi norm, if you remember. Okay, so some cases X can be a set of functions, right? So T then takes a function to another function. So in order to not confuse functions with other functions, right, we sometimes call T an operator, right? So it operates on X to give you another element in X. Okay, so this is just giving it a different name. Okay, so we're going to define the operator X to X to be a contraction mapping. So is a contraction mapping. And the following holds. Well, there exists a number B beta, which is between 0 and 1, but excluding 1, so it has to be strictly smaller than 1. And then for all X and Y in the vector space, if I look at T of X, right, so this is T with input X. I can also write it like this, TX minus TY. The distance between these two vectors should be smaller or equal to beta times the distance between X and Y, okay? So this is the definition of a contraction mapping. Okay, so let's, for example, this is my Banach vector space X. I have an element X, I have an element Y. There's some distance between these two elements, okay? And then you look at T of X, right? So what's T? It takes an X and X and produces another element in X, right? So it maps from somewhere inside the set to somewhere inside the set, okay? So this is under the mapping X. Gives you the element T of X, okay? You can do the same for Y. Maps Y under T gives you another element T of Y. Okay, so when do we have a contraction mapping? Well, because this beta is smaller than 1, we have that this here, this distance is strictly greater than this distance, okay? So the distance between TX and TY has to be smaller than the distance between X and Y. Okay, so it means that if I take two elements and I look at their image under the mapping T, they come closer together, okay? Now, of course, you can look at T of X, you can write this T squared X. You can look at T of Y, call this T squared Y. Then once more, the distance between these two has to be smaller than the distance between these two, okay, because I can put T squared X here, T squared Y here, then this becomes TX and this becomes TY. So here the distance has to be smaller than this, right? So the more you iterate this process, the closer these two vectors are going to get, okay? So this is the idea behind the contraction mapping. And we're going to see contraction mappings in respect to what we call fixed points. Okay, so let me define what a fixed point is. So again, we start with an operator or a function from X to X. Then we say that x is a fixed point of t if t of x is equal to x. Okay, so in principle it's a very simple definition, but if I look at my set x here, so when is this element a fixed point? Let's call this z. Well, if I look at the mapping t of z, it brings it back to the same element. All right, so it's basically a loop. Okay, so the question is, when does a mapping, right, a mapping, when does it have a fixed point? Okay, and this is a famous result that we're going to prove, is that when T is a contraction mapping and X is a Banach space, then there's always a fixed point and there's a unique fixed point. Okay, so this is what we're going to prove. So let me write it down. So X is a Banach space. Okay, so this is important. This is why you spend so much time in previous lecture on how to define Banach spaces. And then T from X to X is a contraction mapping. Well, then T has unique fixed point. Okay, so this means that there's a fixed point and there's only one of them, right? There cannot be two. And if I look at the n of any x0, right? So for every x0 and x, right? So this is a vector. I look at t of x0, then t squared of x0, then t third of x0, right? So I look at the path that x0 has under the mapping t. And I measure the distance from this iteration to the fixed point, then this is smaller or equal to beta to the power n x0 minus x. Okay, so what does this mean? If I start at any point x0 and I iterate the mapping t, then because this is simply a fixed number, right? This is the initial distance between, so this is x0, this is x. Okay, if I look at the mapping t, then what happens? X0 can fly around in the x space, but the distance between these mappings and the fixed point here will become smaller and smaller and smaller, right? And because this beta is smaller than 1, greater or equal to 0, this beta to the power n will go to 0, right? So after n iterations, basically we will get very, very close to the fixed point. Okay, so the first part tells you that there's a fixed point. The second part basically tells you how to find the fixed point or how to get arbitrarily close to the fixed point. You just start by any element in the vector space and iterate the mapping a number of times, and after this number of times you will get very close to the fixed point x. All right, so we're going to prove this result. So this is also called the Banach fixed point theorem, or the contraction mapping theorem. So we're going to prove this. And the idea of the proof is going to be very simple. Basically, we're going to start with any x0 and x, and we're going to look at t of x0, right? We're going to see what's the vector that's going to be equal to t of x0, right? One mapping over the operator t. And let's call this the vector x1. Okay, and we know that because t goes from x to x, x1 is also an element in x. Okay. Then what we're going to do is we're going to take this x1 and map it again, right? T of x1, and this is the same as applying t twice to x0. So we can also write it like this. And let's call this x2. And again, this is an element of x, right? Because t maps from x to x. we can continue doing this. We can look at t of x2, which would be equal to t3 x0. It's also an elec x. Let's call this x3, and so on. Okay, so in general, x n plus 1 is going to be the mapping from t of xn, and this is going to apply n t n plus 1 times to x0. This will also be x, okay, and so on. Right, so we start with any x0, and we'll look at the mapping under t, and then again, and then again, and then again. Okay, so we're just moving around in the space x under the mapping t. And you see that this is a sequence, right? This will generate a sequence. In the space x. And we're going to look at the limiting behavior of this sequence. Okay, so what we're going to do, show that the sequence converges. Basically, we're going to show that it converges to the fixed point that you are looking for. And how are we going to do this? Well, because X is a Banach space, it suffices for us to show that this set, or this sequence, is a Cauchy sequence, right? Because we know that every Cauchy sequence converges. So basically, what we need to show is that for any n and m big enough, the distance between xn and xm converges to zero. Okay, so let's first have a look at two consecutive elements. All right, xn plus 1 minus xn. Well, we know that xn plus 1 is equal to t of xn. All right, so xn plus 1 is t of xn. And xn is equal to t of xn minus 1. Okay. Now, by the contraction mapping, we know that this is smaller or equal to xn minus xn minus 1. Right? This is the definition of a contraction. Of course, xn is equal to t of xn minus 1. Xn minus 1 is equal to t of xn minus 2. And then again, using the notion of a contraction mapping, this is beta, distance between xn minus 1 minus xn minus 2. So we will get beta squared, distance xn minus 1 minus xn minus 2. And we can continue doing this, all right, until here we arrive at x0, right? So in the end, we're going to have x1 here minus x0. So how many times can we do this? Here n minus 2, and we had a square here. This is n minus n, so you have a beta to the power n here. Okay. So we see that this distance here, x1 minus x0, this is just a number. It doesn't depend on n. This depends on n, but it becomes arbitrarily small as n grows arbitrarily big, right? So this is like the notion that you want for a Cauchy sequence. So let's now prove that we have a Cauchy sequence, all right? So we're going to take xn minus xm. You have to show that this goes to zero for n and m going to infinity. Okay, so for now, let's take n bigger than m without loss of generality. Okay, so then we have that this is, so we can add and subtract the same element over and over again, and then we can use the triangle inequality, right, to get that this is less or equal to xn minus xn minus 1 plus xn minus 1 minus xn minus 2 plus xn minus 2 minus xn minus 3 and so on until we get to xn plus 1 minus xn. Okay, so this is just expanding this thing here. And now we use the inequalities that we got on the consecutive terms, right? So the first one, smaller or equal to beta to the power n minus 1, x1 minus x0. The second one is beta n minus 2, x1 minus x0, and so on until beta to the power m x1 minus x0. Okay, and these terms are all the same. So let's put them in front of the summation. And then you have a sum from t equal to m until n minus 1 of beta to the power m, x1 minus x0. Here we add up non-negative numbers until n minus 1. So this will be less or equal to adding up numbers until infinity. Okay, so this is a simple trick, and because this is non-negative, this inequality holds. And you know this is a geometric series, so we know that this is x1 minus x0, the first term beta to the power m divided by 1 minus beta. And what happens now if n and m go to infinity? Well, there's no n anymore here, but there's an m. So this goes, m goes to infinity, beta is smaller than 1. So this converges to 0. Okay, so this shows that for any n and m, if both go to infinity, then their distance goes to 0. So xn is squishy. And then because x is Banach, is a Banach space, you know that xn converges to some element in x, right? So say that xn converges to x. Okay, so we have found the limit. Okay, so that's the first step. We have shown that this sequence of iterated vectors actually converges to something in the vector space. So now we're going to have to show that this x here, so we want to show that x is a fixed point. So in particular, we want to show that t of x is equal to x. Okay, so here's the trick that we're going to use. We're going to measure the distance between t of x and x. Okay, so we know that this is less or equal to, let's add and subtract the same element, which we're going to make t n of x0. Okay, the nth iteration of x0, and then you have to add it again. So t n x0 minus x. Okay, and the triangle inequality, this mixes an inequality here. All right, and then we use once the fact that it's a contraction mapping. So this is x minus t n minus 1 of x0 plus, just repeat this term, t n of x0 minus x. Okay. So what do we know? We know that the sequence of t n's x0, right, because here, well, this is the same as, remember, t n minus 1 of x0 was x n minus 1, right, and t to the power n x0 was the element x n in the sequence. Okay, and if n is, becomes very big, then this converges to 0, and this converges to 0. Right, so by choosing n big enough, this becomes arbitrarily small. So this number, which does not depend on n, right, this is just a fixed number, can be made arbitrarily small by taking n big enough. Okay, and the only number that's smaller or equal to any arbitrarily small non-negative number is going to be 0. Okay, so this implies that tx minus x is equal to 0. And the only element for which the norm is equal to 0 is the 0 element. So this means that tx is equal to x. Okay, so x is a fixed point. Okay. So far, what have we shown? We have shown that there's a fixed point, right? T has a fixed point. But remember, what we also wanted to show is that the fixed point is unique. Okay, so let's show that it's unique. So what are we going to do? We're going to say, okay, take two fixed points, and then we're going to show that they're the same. Okay, so if any two fixed points is the same, there's only one fixed point. Okay, so let x and x, let's call it x hat, our fixed points of t. So what do we know? We know that t of x is equal to x, and we know that t of x hat is equal to x hat. Okay, so let's take the distance between x and x hat. So we know that this is equal to the distance between t of x minus t of x hat, right? Because x is equal to t of x and x hat is equal to t of x hat. And then by the contraction mapping definition, this is smaller or equal to beta of x minus x hat. Okay, so x minus x hat is smaller or equal to beta times the same number, right? So these two numbers are the same and this beta is smaller than 1. So this can only be true because this is non-negative, right? This can only be true if x minus x hat, the distance between the two is equal to 0. So by definition of the norm, this means that x is equal to x hat. So any two fixed points are the same, which means that there's only one unique fixed point. So we have proven the most important result in this lecture, which was that any contraction mapping has unique fixed point. Okay, so now we're going to, let's call it a lemma, we're going to state and prove a lemma. And this lemma might seem a bit far-fetched at the moment, but this is something that we're going to use over and over again in the theoretical parts of this lecture. All right, at some points I'm going to say, oh, but remember the lemma that we have shown in lecture 3, and then this is going to be the lemma that I will refer to. So let me first explain the idea. So this is my vector space, normed vector space, or Banach space, right, that we're interested in. And let's assume that there is a subset x prime of x, okay? So x prime is a subset of x. And assume that for all x and x prime, okay, so any vector in the subset, t of x prime is also an x prime, okay? So if I have an x here, sorry, this should not be an x prime, t of x is also an x prime. Okay, so if I have an x here and I look at the mapping t, I'm again an x prime. Okay, so I will never jump, it's impossible for me to go from some y here to some t of y outside the set, right? So this is not allowed. My mapping t is such that it only brings elements from x prime into elements of x prime. So what can we do? We can iterate this further and further, and we know from the previous result that this converges to the fixed point. Okay, so if you're moving around in the set x prime, and we know that the limit of the sequence of vectors that we're going to get is going to get us to the unique fixed point, right? This was the previous result. Well then, if this x prime is a closed set, which means that every sequence that converges, the limit of this sequence is also in the set, right? That's the definition of being a closed set. Well, then we know that the fixed point will also be in the set, right? For example, here. Okay, so this is the main gist of this lemma. Okay, so let's now state it more formally. Okay, so let x prime be a closed subset of x, okay, and remember what it means to be closed. Okay, so for all sequences xn and x prime, if xn converges to some x, then this x is also an x prime, right? So this is the definition of being closed. The limit of any convergent sequence in the set is also in the set, okay. So x prime is a closed subset of x, and for all x and x prime, t of x is also an x prime. Okay, so sometimes you can write this as t of x prime, right? The mapping of this set x prime will only map to x prime. Okay, so stating this or this, this is the same kind of notation. Okay, so this is a big X, this is a small x. Okay. Well, then the unique fixed point of T, right? So I forgot to say, so T goes from X to X is a contraction mapping. Okay, then unique fixed point of T, which we know exists by the previous theorem, is an X prime. Okay. So the proof is very easy. It basically follows this logic. Okay, so let's take any x0 n x prime. Okay, so I should have said x as a closed non-empty subset. Okay, so we take any x0 n x prime and we look at the sequence xn, where xn is equal to t to the power n of x0, n times repeated mapping under x0. Okay, well then we know that xn is an x prime for all n, right? Why? Because x0 is an x prime, t of x0 is an x prime, t squared of x0 is an x prime, and so on, because of this, right? And xn converges to x, right? This is by the previous theorem. Where was it? This thing here, which is something that you can, I don't think we have proven this exactly, but it's something that you can very easily prove from the results in the theorem. So let's try it for yourself, right? So xn converges to x, you know that x prime is closed, so x is an x prime. Okay, and that's the proof. Okay, so that's the first part of the lemma. There's a second part. All right, so let's let x prime be closed and let x double prime be a subset of x prime. Okay, so now you have here the set x, you have a set x prime, and then you have a subset of the set x double prime, and now we do not assume necessarily that x double prime is a closed set, right? Maybe open, maybe partly open, partly closed, or neither of the two. Okay, so it's just any subset, and you assume that for all x and x prime, t of x is an x double prime. Okay, so if I have an element here, an x prime, then I'm sure it's going to map to an element and x double prime. Okay, well then x, remember, which is the fixed point of t, will be an x double prime. Okay, so the proof is very easy by part one. So what do we have? We have that for all x, t of x and x prime, t of x is an x double prime, and you know that x double prime is a subset of x prime. So t of x will also be an x prime. Okay, so it satisfies the conditions of the previous part in the lemma. Okay, so by part one, we know that x is an x prime. Okay, the fixed point has to be an x prime, and because x prime is closed, and it satisfies this condition. So then because x is an x prime, satisfies this condition, so t of x should be an x double prime, and because x is a fixed point, you know that t of x is equal to x, so x should be an x double prime. Okay, so that's the proof. It's very easy. If this would be a fixed point, then t of x should map to x double prime, so this cannot be a fixed point, so any fixed point has to be an x double prime. So what are we going, why are we going to use this? Well, for example, x prime can be a set. Let's assume that we have vectors and the vectors have a color, right? And let x prime be a set of blue vectors. Or any other desirable property that you liked the fixed point to have, okay? So if xi prime is a set of blue vectors, and if every blue vector x maps, so for all blue vectors x, t of x is also blue, okay? But then we can use this lemma to show that if the set of blue vectors is closed, then the fixed point will also be blue, okay? And for example, we would like to have it not blue, but for example, dark blue, right? So x double prime is a set of dark blue vectors. And if you know that any blue vector maps to something that's dark blue, right, then the fixed point will be dark blue. Okay, so this is basically how we're going to use this property. We're going to fix some desirable property that we think the fixed point should have, right, or that we want to show the fixed point to have. So examples can be, if we talk about spaces of functions, could be convexity or monotonicity or any other desirable mathematical property. So if you can show that all the elements with this property is closed and that any element with this property maps to another element with this property, well, then you know that the fixed point will have this nice property, right? So this is how we can use quantitative or qualitative properties of the fixed point. And then any x double prime, which is a subset of the desirable property. So for example, this could be strict monotonicity or strict quasi-concavity, or as we will see in the future, right? Then if you can see that everything with a desirable property also has this extra desirable property, then you know that the fixed point is has this extra desirable property, right? So this is how we're going to use this, these two, or this lemma in two parts. All right, before we continue, let's have a short break. Okay, welcome back. So previously we talked about operators on vector spaces. Right, so we started with this vector space, but in previous lecture we mainly focused on one particular vector space, which was the set of all functions from A to R that are first of all continuous and bounded in the phi norm. Okay, and we have shown that this is Banach. So if it's Banach, if you can find a contraction mapping on the space, it will have unique fixed points. Okay, so what's now an operator or a function from C phi A to C phi A? Well, this is a set of functions. So this takes a function to another function. Okay, so here T takes functions okay. So I think most people are familiar with mappings or functions that take numbers to other numbers, or maybe even vectors to other vectors, but now we're talking about mappings that take a function to another function, right? So we give it an entire function, right, and it produces another entire function. Okay, so this is how you should see it. So if f is a function, then we're looking at the mapping t of f. Okay, and then this is a function, right? So we can evaluate it at a certain element of A. Okay, so let x be an A. Then we can, if this is equal to g, then we can look at g of x, right? So this is the number in R. It's this function evaluated at x. Okay, so you can write it as t of f evaluated at x. Okay, so this is now a bit of an annoying notation, right? Because here we have a bracket, here we have a bracket. It's a bit confusing whether f is now the element here or whether x is now the element here or what are we talking about. Okay, so often we write this as tf evaluated at x, right? So this is now here the new function and we evaluate the new function at x. Okay, so instead of this, writing t between brackets f, we often write tf without brackets. Okay, and now you can think of this as being a new function, right? So often, if f is a function, we don't write the brackets, we don't write it like this, but we write it like this without brackets. And then if we evaluate it at x, then either we write it as tf at x, or if it's unclear, we can write it as tf evaluated at x. Okay, so this is just notation. Okay, so we're talking about an operator t from c phi on some set A to c phi on some domain A. And we know that, okay, if t is a contraction mapping, then it has a unique fixed point, right? Because this is a Banach space. So remember the condition for contraction mapping says that for every function f and g in c phi of A, the phi norm between tf and tg, okay, should be less or equal to beta times the phi norm distance between f and g. Okay, so there should exist a beta between strictly below one. Okay, so this is the definition of contraction. And this has to be satisfied for every f and g. So often this is a very annoying property to verify. Okay, so now we're going to give a result. This is called Blackwell's theorem. And this Blackwell's theorem is going to give a very easy to verify set of conditions such that T is a contraction mapping. Okay. It's going to be sufficient conditions, they're not necessary conditions. Okay. But in many cases of the dynamic optimization, these Blackwell conditions will be the ones that we're going to check. We're not going to check this one, we're going to check the conditions that are here. Okay, so let T be a mapping from C phi A to C phi A. And we're going to assume that it satisfies the following two conditions. So the first is called monotonicity. Okay, so it's monotonicity says that if for all A in the domain, if for all X in the domain, F of X is less or equal to G of X, right? So this is for all F and G and C phi of A. If this is the case, well then for all X and A, TF at X is lower or equal to TG at X. Okay, so the mapping preserves the order over functions. And this is a partial order because it has to hold for any X, right? So if I have two functions, F and G, so if F is smaller than g at every point, right? So the one function is above the other function at every point. Then if you look at the mapping, for example, this is t of f, I don't know, then t of g also has to be above t of f. Okay, so this is what it says. So normally we don't write this, we just write if f is smaller or equal to g, then t of f is smaller or equal to t of g. Okay, so we normally omit for all. If you write this, it's understood that this has to hold for every part in the domain. Okay, so this is monotonicity. And then there's a second property that's called discounting. Okay, and this says that there should exist a beta between 0 and 1, 1 not included, right? So strictly smaller than 1. So for all x in the domain, and for all f in c phi of a, and for all a greater or equal to 0, the following inequality holds. So I look at the function f plus a times phi, right? So phi is a function, continuous function from, remember, phi goes from a to r plus plus, and it's continuous. Okay, so this is a function f plus a phi. Okay, at every point I add a times phi to the function, and I look at the mapping of this function, and this should be lower or equal to tf. Okay, so of course this evaluated at x. Okay, this will be lower than tf evaluated at x plus beta times a phi evaluated at x. Okay, so here this is the mapping of this function. Here this is the mapping of this function alone. Okay, and this is called discounting. Okay, so the theorem says that under 1 and 2, if these two conditions hold, then T is a contraction mapping. Okay, let's have a look at the proof. So what do we want to show is that we want to show that for any fg in c phi of a, tf minus tg to norm smaller or equal to beta, for some beta strictly less than 1, of f minus g. Fine. Okay, so this is what we should want to show. And recall what this is, right? This is the phi norm, so it's the sub of x and a of tf at x minus tg at x divided by phi of x. Okay, so this is what we have. Okay, let's start. So the start is very easy. You look at fx over phi of x, and we just rewrite this as g of x over phi of x plus, well, what remains, right? Fx minus gx over phi of x, right? So this is a simple identity. And then this is less or equal to gx over phi of x plus, instead of taking the difference, we can take the absolute value of the difference. So we obtain this. Okay, so this is us replacing this by the absolute value, and we get a less or equal sign. So this norm here is the sub of x and a of fx minus gx divided by phi x. Okay, this is evaluated at x, and this is the sub, right? So the sub is an upper bound, so this is less or equal to gx divided by phi x plus f minus g phi norm. Okay. So if we multiply everything by phi, we have that f of x is less or equal to g of x plus f minus g phi times phi of x. And now we use monotonicity. So this is a function, okay, and c phi a. This is a function, and this is also a function, okay? So if we use monotonicity, we can take t of f x, right? We just take the mapping of this function under t, should be less or equal to the mapping of this function here under t. So t of g plus f minus g phi of x, and is evaluated at x. Okay, so this is t of this function, and then this here, this whole function here is evaluated at x. Okay, and now use additivity, f plus a phi. So we can put this, this is simply a number, right, as a distance between two functions, so we can put this into a. So we know that this is less or equal to tg at x plus a f minus g phi, and then you had the beta, right, this beta here times phi of x. Now we put this to the other side, so that we have tf divided by x minus tg evaluated at x. We can divide by phi x is less or equal to f minus g phi times beta. Okay, and then we can do the same thing all over again, except that now we exchange f and g. Okay, if we do this, well, then everywhere where we have f, we have g. Everywhere where we have g, we have f. Phi x is smaller than beta, and here we have the same, f minus g or g minus f, it's the same distance. Okay. Now, if a is smaller than something and minus a is smaller than something, well, then the absolute value is also smaller, right? Phi of x is smaller than beta. Okay. So what do we have now? This doesn't depend on x, right? It's just a fixed number. And here we took x arbitrary, right? It was just any element in the domain. So for any element in the domain, this is a something that's bigger, right? So this is an upper bound for this when you range over all the x's. So in particular, the supremum should also be less or equal to this part here. And the supremum is nothing else than tf minus tg. The phi norm is smaller or equal to beta f minus g, the phi norm. And this is the definition of a contraction mapping. So we are done. Okay, so far so good. So this is Blackwell's theorem. So in order to verify that a function or an operator is a contraction mapping, you only need to verify monotonicity and additivity. So Blackwell's theorem is normally known when we just have CA, right? So remember, CA was a set of all continuous functions that are bounded. Okay, so this corresponds to C phi of A, where phi of x is just the constant function. Okay, so here F A to R was all these functions that are continuous. Bounded. So in this case, Blackwell's theorem also holds, right? Because it's, this is a special case of the more general case. And monotonicity is the same, right? F smaller than g, then t of f has to be smaller than t of g. The second additivity condition is a bit more easy, because now we look at the mapping tf plus a phi, but phi is equal to the constant function 1, right? So this is just tf plus a, where a is greater or equal to 0. And then this has to be less or equal to tf evaluated at some x, right? So this is pointwise inequality, tf plus beta a. Okay, so monotonicity is the same, additivity is a bit easier because you're not dragging along the phi function with it, but this is Blackwell's theorem for C, a mapping that goes from CA to CA. Okay, so for T going from CA to CA. Okay, this was everything I wanted to say in this lecture. So thanks for watching.